wanna be that lie to make a second guess who I'm representing. And no, I'm not perfect. No, I'm not ashamed to confess. I just want you to see that I'm trying. And no, it's not a game. Ain't gonna lose no sleep over what people say.
Just let me live my life. Ah, you ain't giving me my life. Nah, you can't tell me what's right. Ah, you ain't laid down.
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 He made me great. So let me be great.
Oh.
Good evening, Student Ministries. Guess what tonight is? Tonight is Takeover Tuesday. Look, I'm excited, so excited tonight. We have a very special guest all the way from Dallas, Texas, Pastor Dwayne High. Pastor High has a major word for us tonight. And so, look, I want you to pay close attention to what he has to say. We're going to have some worship. We're going to have the word. But before all of that, I need you to do me a favor. Can you do it? I sure hope so. Look, share this. Share this live with your friends. Share with your family. Share with your cousins and your aunties. We have something great in store for y'all tonight. And if you have some friends that you want to invite to the service, just send them a text. We want everybody that we can to get in on this. For grades 6th through 12th grade, it is time for Takeover Tuesday. And look, you don't want to miss this because tomorrow night, we're going to follow up in our small group, which is called our safe space. We're going to follow up with a conversation about tonight. So listen, as the service is going on, pay close attention. And also, do what I ask you to do. Text somebody. It's going to be an amazing night.
Good evening. I'll be reading Proverbs 3, verses 5 and 6. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not into thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. Everybody, bow your heads and close your eyes for the word of prayer. Dear Lord, thank you for this day and waking me up this morning and giving me another day. I ask that you watch over the youth and members of this church, and protect them and keep them safe. I pray that you guide us in the right direction. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Everything about you is right.
Covers all my wrongs.
Your love saved my life.
What's up, my St. Bartley youth? My name is Dwayne High, and I serve as the executive pastor all the way in Dallas, Texas, at the Antioch Fellowship Missionary Baptist Church. I am coming to you by way of your youth minister, Minister Tiffany Sledge. She's asked me to come on and just share with y'all just a small excerpt, a little Bible study, so that y'all can have some productive conversation. So I want to talk to you from Psalms 23. If you got your Bible, take your Bible out and go with me to Psalms chapter 23, all right? Now, if you're seeing Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Revelation, Acts, you're on the wrong side of the Bible. Go kind of sort of the other way. Meet me at Psalms chapter 23. I only want to look at one verse. And if you don't have a Bible, hopefully you have a Bible. But if you don't have a Bible, then you can look at this screen behind me where we have this text up, all right? Do me a favor, if you will, bow your heads real quick and let's pray. Father, today we ask in the name of Jesus that you would bless our time together. I ask now, God, in the name of Jesus, that you would remove any distractions, anything that's getting in our way, and allow us to hear from you. Allow us to hear your voice. Allow our hearts to be open to what you have to say. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right. So listen, I just want to talk to you for a quick second, but I need y'all to know this first, that if you're not a fan of the University of Alabama, I'm completely confused with what you're doing with your life. But once again, we are the national champions. Another announcement that I need to make with you is that if you're not a fan of the LeBron James, he's the king of Ohio and also the best player in the NBA. And once again, he is a champion. I want to make sure that you knew those and keep those in your hearts. Okay. Psalms 23 verse 1 reads like this. The Lord is my shepherd. You see that? The Lord is my shepherd. And the second part that is just as important as the first part, I shall not want. Say it with me. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Say it one more time. The Lord is my shepherd and I shall not want. Psalms chapter 23 is a scripture written by a biblical character named David. You may know him from the story of David and Goliath. You may know him as the king of Israel. What you may not know about David is that David was once a shepherd. David was once a shepherd. And he goes from being a shepherd to being a king. Now, I don't have a lot of time to say this, but let me tell you this. That just basically means that no matter where you start, God may have a completely different ending for you. That you can start in a place where nobody cares, that nobody knows about, and you can end up being great. That you can start at a place of not having a dad and end up being an amazing father. That you can start in a place of not growing up in a great family and end up having an amazing family of your own. You can start in a place where you struggle in school and end up becoming an amazing success. That no matter where you start with God, you can end at a place that's totally different than where you began. David was a shepherd that ended up becoming a king. And David, after his time of being king, after his experience with God, writes Psalms 23. And it is an amazing chapter of the Bible. I encourage you to read all of it. But let me just point out this one scripture to you. The Lord is my shepherd and I shall not want. What does a shepherd do? Go ahead and answer that. Okay, I'll answer it for you. A shepherd cares for sheep. A shepherd guides sheep. A shepherd protects sheep. A shepherd nurtures sheep. This is important because David was once a shepherd. And David says, now that he's king, the Lord is my shepherd. Let's have a conversation about sheep for a second, because sheep are defenseless animals. Sheep lack the ability to protect themselves. Sheep are very inconsistent thinkers, which means sheep oftentimes make decisions that don't make sense. Sheep oftentimes will eat anything that's before them. One person said, if you put a couch before a group of sheep, sheep will eat off the couch. Sheep have a family, but they need a shepherd. Sheep have relationships, but they need shepherds. Sheep have the ability to move, and sheep have the ability to speak, but they need a shepherd because sheep can't protect themselves. Sheep don't always eat the right food. Sheep don't always know where to go. Sheep make decisions, but their decisions don't often make sense because sheep need a shepherd. If I could take you a little bit further, I want you to say this to yourself as I say it. I am sheep. I am inconsistent with my thinking. I lack the ability to properly be able to protect myself. I don't always make the best decisions. I oftentimes find myself in places that I never was supposed to end up in. I have family. I have relationships. I have decisions. I can do stuff on my own. But the harsh reality is I need a shepherd. I need somebody who sees more in me, who will protect me, who will take care of me, who will nurture me, who will feed me, who will lead and guide me to the right place. I am sheep and I need a shepherd. That's why David writes, "The Lord is my shepherd," because even as a king, he realized that he couldn't do it by himself. He writes, "The Lord is my shepherd," because even as a man, he realized that he didn't have it all together. He says, "The Lord is my shepherd," because he realized after getting money, money wouldn't solve his issues. He says, "The Lord is my shepherd," because he got into relationships and had successful relationships and realized that even with relationships, there was still something in him that was not fixed, and he needed someone greater to fix what was in him. I'm trying to suggest to you that in our lives, we have determined what's going to fix us, what's going to fill that void in our lives, what's going to make our lives better, what we need to get to where we want to be in our hearts and in our heads. And I'm here to suggest to you that without a shepherd, you will get there and not enjoy it. Without a shepherd, without God in your life, without God as the sustainer and the chief priority of your lives, the harsh reality is we will get everything we want and miss out on everything we need. Can you write that down? Can I say that again? That a lot of us will work as hard as we can to get everything we want, but we will miss out on everything we need. David says that the Lord is my shepherd. The reason why I mention this to you is because David is also a Christian and David believes in God. But when David says, "The Lord is my shepherd," David is telling them about a decision that he's made, right? Because a lot of people can be in church and not be a Christian. And then there's a lot of people who say they're a Christian, but the Lord isn't their shepherd. And the reason why he says, "The Lord is my shepherd," is because he's declaring the decision he's made, that the Lord is his shepherd. And I want to challenge you today. I want you to ask yourself a question. Who's your shepherd? Who inspires the decisions you make? Who inspires the places you go? Who inspires what you do? Or it may not be who, it may be what. What inspires what you do? I would venture to say that the first step of being a Christian is finding out who your shepherd is. And if I could go down the list of things, a lot of us are shepherds to money. A lot of us are a lot of us are sheep to money. A lot of us become sheep to ideas and dreams. A lot of us become sheep to celebrities. If I'm honest, a lot of us become sheep to TikTok and Snapchat and Instagram. I don't know if y'all still use Instagram. And if you as old as Miss Tiffany, a lot of us are sheep to Facebook and MySpace. But a lot of us become sheep, which means a lot of us follow stuff that don't matter. And I can prove to you if the Lord is your shepherd or not by the second part of this. I shall not want. The first thing you know, or the first thing you'll realize once you make the Lord your shepherd is that you realize you have everything you need, right? There is this contentment and this fulfillment that happens on the inside of you when you allow the Lord to become your shepherd and you make that relationship personal. And what happens when the Lord isn't your shepherd is that you find yourself in situations where you always need more than what you got. You always feel like there's a hole on the inside of you, that there are unmet needs, there are unmet desires, that it's always this searching for more. And what do we normally do in this life? We find stuff to fill that time and to fill those holes. So some of us may have tried drugs. Some of us may have tried sex. Some of us may have tried relationships. Some of us have filled up our empty time with games and friends and social media and other type of things. And what we found out is no matter how much I do this stuff, I still feel empty on the inside. No matter how much I do this stuff, I still find myself wanting more. And even if I'm honest, because I've been in church and I've been here, even I find myself praying to God, asking him for the things I want, although I serve other things. So I go to God to fulfill my needs, but I go to other things to shepherd me. So I want you just to take this moment, take a couple moments, and I want you to think about whether or not, based off what I said, am I content with my life? Do I find myself following the things God want me to follow? Do I find myself enjoying the things God want me to enjoy? Do I find myself being taken away from the things that are not good for me? Is the Lord my shepherd? And if that's not enough for you, then I want you to ask yourself a different question. Is my life feeling empty? Are there holes in my life that I haven't found a way to plug up? Is the friends I have, are they friends that lead me to what God has created me to do? Or are there friends to try to supplement the fact that I have the wrong shepherd? If I could take a couple minutes, I would suggest to you, you know you have the wrong shepherd when you need so many other people to help supplement the fact that the thing I'm following ain't feeding me. You know you have the wrong shepherd when I find myself in a relationship and I'm in a relationship because being in this relationship is better than being alone. You know you have the wrong shepherd when I'm in school, but I can't focus on school because I'm preoccupied by the people and the things that take up so much space and place in my life. And I'm in school and I'm struggling in the thing that's supposed to help me. I'm struggling in the thing that's supposed to grow me. I'm struggling in the thing that's supposed to provide for me because of the things that I serve when I'm not in here. I can prove to you, or I want you to be able to diagnose whether or not you have the right or wrong shepherd as it pertains to your relationship with your church. Is it just boring? Does it just feel like another thing to do? Are you struggling to read your word? Does prayer not make sense to you? Do you feel lost or unaccepted or rejected when you come into this building or when you come into these Zoom calls? It could be that there's nothing wrong with the church. I can give you, it could be that there's nothing wrong with you. What if I suggested to you that there's a potential that you have the wrong shepherd? And I want to challenge you today, this morning, to choose the right shepherd. You know who he is. His name is Jesus Christ. But although he wants to be your shepherd, he won't make you his sheep. Do you understand what I'm saying? What I'm saying is, Jesus won't make you choose him, but he will offer. And for some strange reason, God had this guy all the way from Dallas, Texas, come to remind you that he still wants relationship with you. He still wants to be your shepherd. He wants you to be a part of his family. He wants you to belong to him. The benefit of you belonging to Christ is that the Bible says you shall not want. That God is in your life to provide you with everything you need. Now, I'm finished, but I want to remind you that there's a difference between what I need and what I want. Right? And when David says, I shall not want, what David is saying is, not only does God provide me with everything that I need and everything I want, but I accept everything he allows and I accept the things that God say no to. That God doesn't love you less because he doesn't give you the stuff you don't need. So I'm giving you an opportunity today to do a little soul searching, or y'all have a conversation about this after y'all finish watching this, about whether or not God is in my life what the scripture says he is to me. Is the Lord your shepherd? But then I want you to have a separate conversation after you finish that one. Am I the type of sheep that God has called me to be? Am I the type of son, the type of daughter that listens to what the Father says, that obeys the Father's command, that follows everywhere the Father has led me? That's all I got for y'all. Now listen, I want y'all to have some positive conversations. And don't give the church answer. Be real. Talk about where you struggle. Talk about where it doesn't make sense. Talk about how, based off of where you come from and the house you live in and the situations and circumstances that brought you to this moment, is keeping you from surrendering and submitting to God. And it is our job as your church family to help you get there. Love y'all. See y'all soon.
Hey, y'all. Listen, was tonight not amazing? I told you that it would be. What an amazing word. Pastor High, we want to say thank you for pouring into us tonight. That is just what we needed. Look, students, ask yourself this question. Is God really my shepherd? Ask yourself the question. Think about it. And then tomorrow night in our small group, in our safe space, we're going to talk about this. We're going to dig deeper on how it is necessary for God to be our shepherd. Also, I want to offer Christ to you. I don't know what you may be going through. Life may be real good for you right now, but even with Christ, life is better. So I want to offer Christ to you if he's not already your Savior. If you want to even rededicate your life to God, here's an opportunity to do so. Look, my information is below. You can send me a text and say, hey, Miss Tiffany, I want to give my life to Christ. Or, hey, Miss Tiffany, I want to rededicate my life. Listen, God wants us so close, and it is so good to be close to God, and it's so good to have a relationship with God. And so, listen, kids, I'm here for y'all. Reach out to me if you need anything, if you even need prayer. Listen, text the number below, send me an email, and say, hey, I just need prayer. But look, I hope you enjoyed Takeover Tuesday. I hope you're going to meet me tomorrow in Zoom in our safe space. We got a lot to talk about, and it's going to be real good. Tell a friend, tell a cousin, tell somebody. Listen, meet us on Zoom tomorrow night as we continue this conversation that Pastor High has started. Look, that's all I got for tonight. I love y'all. I'm going to pray. I hope y'all have an amazing week. And so let's go to God for prayer. God, we thank you and we love you and we bless you and we honor you. God, we thank you tonight for what you allowed for us to experience. God, we thank you, Lord, that we can look to you and you are our shepherd. God, we thank you for being our shepherd. And God, we thank you that we don't have to want for anything because you are our shepherd. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray over our students right now. God, keep them safe. Keep them in perfect peace until we meet again. This is our prayer. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Students, y'all have an amazing night. I can't wait to see y'all tomorrow.